Greater Bell Zion. How's everybody doing this morning? God has blessed us one more time. He's let the good sun shine on us. He's given us good health. He's given us a place. He has given us his darling son, Jesus. And I'm mighty grateful this morning, extra grateful this morning, that I can begin chapter 57. Amen. God's a good God. And I thank him for everything that he is in my life today. We hope you came with us to praise because it's service time. We want to welcome everyone that is in Facebook Live. We want to welcome everyone in the community that we serve an awesome God, and he's worthy to be praised. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. We serve a great God. When there's a praise in the temple and a praise in the house, you can usher in the spirit and remove the devil out. God will open up a window and a blessing he'll pour out. When there's a praise in the temple, a praise in the house, it's service time, it's service time. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, with a praise on your mind. It's service time, it's service time. Stay right in your car, don't get up out of your seat, but let's clap to the beat. It's service time, it's service time, it's service time. Oh, enter his gates with thanksgiving, with a praise on your mind. It's service time, it's service time. Stay right in your car, don't get up out of your seat, but just honk to the beat. It's service time.
Giving glory and honor to our Lord Jesus Christ. Today's scripture comes from Psalm 9. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth all thy marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in thee. I will sing praise to thy name, O thou most high. Where mine enemies are turned back, they shall fall and perish at thy presence. For thou hast maintained my right and my cause, thou seated in thy throne, judgment right. Thou hast rebuked the heathen, thou hast destroyed the wicked, thou hast put out their name forever and ever. O thou enemy, destructions are come to a perpetual end, and thou hast destroyed cities, their memorial is perished with them. But the Lord shall endure forever. He hath prepared his throne of judgment for judgment. He shall judge the world in righteousness. He shall minister judgment to the people in uprightness. I've read for you Psalm 9, 1 through 8. May the Lord add his blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. Amen.
Let us all approach the throne of grace. Father God, we just come to you this day, Lord God, in the humblest way we know how, Lord God, with bowed head and humble hearts. Lord God, just pleading the blood of Jesus in our lives. Lord God, we know where you said in your word, if we confess our sins to you, you are the one faithful, you are the one just, to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So, Lord God, we just take this moment to just petition you, Lord God, for that cleansing. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for a place, Lord God, that we can come and worship in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Lord God, for your word, Lord God, peace upon you, Lord God, washes our very soul. Lord God, give us the ability to look in the mirror, Lord God, and to remember the things that you have brought us through, Lord God, and remember the things that, Lord God, you're still working on. We thank you, Lord God, for your mercy, Lord God, which is new every morning. We thank you, Lord God, that you're keeping us and that, Lord God, you have brought us into your presence, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that not only do we have a place of worship and we have your word, Lord God, but we have a relationship with you. Lord God, at this point in time, Lord God, the nation being what it is and the entire world being in disarray, Lord God, you are the one who calms the racing heart, Lord God. and brings to mind peace, Lord God, in times when there's so much travail and so much iniquity. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for the clarity of thought. We thank you, Lord God, for your word that helps us to organize our steps and to see forth a path, Lord God, that is divinely established, Lord God, for your name's sake. We thank you, Lord God, for men and women, Lord God, who stand in the gap, praying, singing, praising and preaching, Lord God, your word, the good news, Lord God, to the world so that we can be saved by the fact that we know who Jesus Christ is and that we accept him as our Savior. Lord God, we thank you for the song service today. We thank you, Lord God, for the weather. We thank you, Lord God, for the traveling mercies, Lord God, as well as things like Facebook Live and other social media devices. Lord God, we just thank you that we can worship you. And we thank you, Lord God, that you will first love us while we was yet sinners. You died for us. So we pray for our service. We pray for every service that is established in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray for our sick. We pray for our shut-in. We pray for our military. We pray for our leadership. We pray for those who are in prison. We pray for those, Lord God, who just don't know what to do. Lord God, just give them hope and give them more understanding. This is all that we can pray. And your precious son of your, and the precious blood of your, and the precious name of your son, Jesus Christ, the one who shed his blood on Calvary. Let the church say, amen.
We praise God as we continue in praise. We are just so grateful for everything that God has given us, all the things that you see that's going on in the country. It could have easily been us facing those things. And so since we are not in the turmoil directly, we can certainly praise God, thank God, and pray for those who are struggling in our behalf. Amen. Song simply says, I just want to praise you. Just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Yeah. where we have unemployment that is higher than it has ever been. You've given us the things that we need, dear Lord. You've given us food. You've given us shelter, and we thank you. Now we are up to the time in our service where we can give back to God, where he is so richly, so freely given to us. So it's offering time, church. Amen. There are several modes of ways that you can give. The officers are coming around to receive. If you're on Facebook, you can definitely donate to this ministry through our Cash App. Our Cash App is New GBZ 1885. Again, that's New GBZ 1885. And we are so thankful for all of you who have so richly given. We're going to turn it over to Deacon Terrell to give an offertory prayer as we father the servant. Praise God.
Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, creator of heaven and earth, maintain and sustain of all we are. Father, we just come this morning to offer you thanksgiving. Thank you for the goodness and the mercy you show toward us. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for the opportunity to stand this morning and to be here this morning. When so much in the world is going on, we understand that we are yet blessed. Father, we come this morning with a petition on our heart. You know what we stand in need of. You know what we need to move forward. We're just asking for your guidance. We ask for your favor. We ask you to bless this offering that's been lifted in your name this morning. May it be used to build up, maintain, and further the gospel cause. In the precious, powerful, matchless name of Jesus our Lord, we give you thanks as we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, Bill Zion. Isn't God good? And I know that he's good all the time. God has blessed us and allowed us to come together once again. Look at the beautiful weather that he has provided for us. Nice cool breeze is blowing, and so we don't want to be out very long, but we want to give God some praise, for he is worthy to be praised. He woke us up this morning, started us on our way. God did not have to wake us up this morning, and so we are not privileged, we're blessed. And we're blessed above many, because many who started out with us on yesterday are no longer with us. So we need to just praise God and lift him up. I want to thank for the scripture reading and also the prayer. Thank you for the song service. And in that vein, I want to wish my lovely wife, who is so young and beautiful, a happy birthday today. Amen, amen. We have some visitors. Visitors, where are you? Okay, we have some visitors today. It's Gina Myers. Where are you, Gina?
Over there, red truck.
Red truck. Okay, all right. We see you. We see you in that pretty red truck. All right. All the visitors, we thank God for you coming today. I'm not going to be long, but we do want to talk about faith and fear again today. I think it's necessary for us. A lot of times, we as people, we fear many things. We fear the past. We fear the future, and especially in pandemic times like this. We fear mistakes. We fear people. We don't know what people are going to do. And especially in the world today, we don't know what people are going to do, what they're going to say, or how they're going to act. We're afraid of sickness. All of us in our lives, sooner or later, if you have an experience, you're going to come down with some sickness. And a lot of times, sickness, it scares us, but you have to understand that all sickness is not unto death. And a lot of times loneliness, especially for octogenarians. They sometimes a lot of the family have gone on to glory, and they are feared of what's going to happen, who's going to take care of them. There's a whole lot of things in our life as Christians that can cause us to worry and to fret about different things. So our message this morning is titled, How Christ Overcame Fear. And that's an example for us, how Christ overcame fear. You can find this in Mark chapter 6, verses 45 through 56. That's Mark 6, 45 through 56. It reads on this way, and it's 3 points that I want you to pick out of this. Number one, the Master's Prayer. I want you to pick up number two, the Master's Power. Number three, the Master's Presence. And so I want you to kind of meditate on those and read it when you go home. This glare is kind of hard on this tablet, so bear with me. And straightway, and I'm reading from the King James, and straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto the Bethsaida, while he sent away the people. And when he had sent them away, he parted into a mountain to pray. And when evening was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land, and he saw them toiling and the rowing, for his wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them walking upon the sea, and would have passed them by. But when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit, and cried out, for they all saw him, and were troubled. And immediately he talked with them, and said unto them, Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And he went up into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were so amazed in themselves beyond measure, and wondered, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. And when they had passed over, they came into the land of Gennesaret, and drew to the shore. And when it were come out of the ship, straightway they knew him, and ran through the whole region about, and began to carry about in beds those who were sick. When they heard he was, and whether they entered into villages or cities or country, they laid their sick in the streets and besought him that they might touch it, if it were but of the border of his garment. And as many as touched him were made whole. The Master's Prayer. In order for us to be able to conquer fear, we're going to have to know the Master, and we're going to have to pray. A lot of times the reason why we are afraid is that we don't have contact with God. We let our imaginations, and we let different other things overcome us rather than looking to the Master of the hour, who is Jesus Christ. So we need to have enough faith. If fear overcomes you, fear is going to mess with your faith. But this is the one thing: if you got faith, you're going to overcome fear. And so Jesus is telling us, and now we've heard this story many times about Jesus, the Master of the sea, of the ocean, the wave. That's true. But I'm coming from a different direction today to show you the faith that God has in his Son, and the Son dispensed to his disciples. And now we have a lesson that we can see how Jesus overcame fear. We have to understand that Jesus went through some of the same things that we go through. As I list off I read off the list this morning, whether it be sickness, whether it be death, whether it be life, whether it be people doing you wrong, backsliding, Jesus had to go through all of that. You say, well, where was Jesus sick? Well, a sickness, the thing about it is that to the heart is where he looked around, and the people that he was trying to heal and take care of, guess what? They turned their backs on him. What about sickness on the cross? God suffered on the cross, because when his body was shedding down, that was pain and suffering. That was sickness right there. But Jesus kept the faith, and he stayed right there. And that's what we're going to have to do. No matter what we are running up against, we're going to have to remain standing. Christians don't have the opportunity to stop and have pity parties for themselves. And I know a lot of times, guess what? We want to do that. We want to stop and have a pity party for ourselves. Things didn't go our way, but the Christian is a peculiar person. A percussion is kind of like that battery. You take a licking and keep on ticking. You've got to keep moving because guess what? If you slow down, if you move slowly, guess what? Satan is right there on your trail and can overtake you. So this is why we encourage you to just keep moving. Be like that duck. When that water rains, it just rolls right off its back. You can't set up an auger with someone who is determined to stop you from doing God's will. You lose time when you stop that. And so Jesus, going on his way to the cross, he prayed not only for himself, but he prayed for his disciples. Guess what, saints? We need to pray for one another. The prayers of the righteous availeth much. We really need to pray for one another. How many times does somebody ask you, say, pray for me? Now, a lot of times we do it right then and there. A lot of times I pray right there on the phone. But when someone says, pray for me, guess what? You need to do that prayer right then and there. Don't forget it two or three days later and say, Sister X asked me to pray for her. Let me set up a prayer. Set up some timber right then and there. And if you're in touching distance, we know that we have to have social. You don't can't hug, but guess what? You can stand there with your hands folded, and you can pray. You can pray in your hoopty. So here Christ sets an example on how to overcome fear. He's teaching them how to pray. There are a lot of folk that don't know how to pray. Don't kid yourself. There's a lot of folk who really don't know how to pray. Praying to Christ is not when you bless your food and say, Jesus, well. That is not prayer. That's thanking God for what you have. But you have to understand that we as Christians, we've got to keep prayer in our lives. In order to make it through, you've got to have a prayer life. You've got to set some time for a prayer life. Sometimes we got to pray on the run. But we need to know that we got to keep moving. Don't let the past stop you from moving forward. We've all fallen and come short of God's glory. None of us are perfect. We have done things in our life that we regret. But guess what? God loves sinners who can make a change, repent, and follow him. It takes a prayer life. It takes a life to ask God to forgive you and move on. So, number one, you got to pray and ask God not only to keep you moving and motivated, but also the saints who surround you. Amen? And so we have to understand that the Master's power, and we do see that. Not only did he pray, but he showed him his power. How many of you know what God is capable of doing? You do know that God can do everything but fail. So that ought to give us some solid foundation. He gave him his prayer, led him into a place. Let me add something else on prayer. You have to sometimes get into that quiet place so you can concentrate. Because everything that's going on around you can deter you from really focusing on what God wants you to do. You cannot hustle and bustle with folk who don't have a prayer life, who don't know Christ. Yeah, you can mix with them. You can try to encourage them to be with Christ. But every now and then, you've got to steal away to that small place so that you can commune with God one-on-one. You can hear him, and he can hear you. Let me give you an example. When God called Moses to the backside of Mount Sinai, when Moses got close, and he told him, and he saw this bush burning, and he knew it was something odd about that bush because the bush was burning on fire, but it wasn't being consumed. And so Moses was looking there, and God told him, says, come closer. And hey, Moses, by the way there, brother, you're walking on holy ground. So you need to take your shoes off. But God brought Moses to the backside of the mountain from tending sheep to where he could talk with him one-on-one. And every now and then, I'm a firm believer that you got to have a one-on-one talk with Jesus Christ, especially when fear is trying to overcome you. And don't kid yourself, fear. Some folk are fear spiders. Some folk don't like frogs. Some folk, well, you can clean a house with roaches. One roach can make folk clear a house. A lot of folk have fears and phobias, but guess is what? You have to overcome it. And how do they do it? To overcome a phobia, you gotta associate yourself with what you're afraid of. So guess what? If you're afraid of something, you gotta address it. How do you address it? With prayer. If you address it with prayer, that's the first thought, and you can get over to the next one. The master's power. Here is a man sleeping in the back of a boat who can get up and say to the winds and the waves, peace be still. Now, if he's got that kind of power, what kind of power you think he's got over our lives? God just wants us to lend him our souls and our bodies. Yes. Because if you don't have control of your soul and your body, you don't have an association with Christ. So you got to give it up. Now, we know that we talk about baby Jesus and, you know, blessing and at Christmas time, we look at the nativity scenes. But guess what? Baby Jesus grew up. And we need to pray to an almighty God who's able to do everything but fail and to keep us from falling. We need to understand that we need to put our trust and our faith in Jesus Christ. Yes, we need to do that. And I think a lot of our problems today is that we don't trust God, no matter if he's on board. Now, you see, used to see these signs that in the back of the truck says, baby on the board, mommy on board, daddy on board, all you know the sign. But one of the most signs that I used to like to see was that Jesus is on board. Now, if Jesus is on board, don't have to be in your car as your co-pilot, but if Jesus is on board, everything will be all right in your life. If you notice, I did not say that you were not going to come through circumstances and situations, but guess what? If you've got God, you can walk it all the way. And that's what he was trying to tell his others. He says, I'm going to show you how I overcame fear. A prime example of God overcoming fear is in the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember? Yeah, he's on his way to a cross. He's on the way to nails in his hands and spikes in his feet. And he stops off by the Garden of Gethsemane. And he prays to the Father, Father, if this bitter cup can be removed, please remove this cup. That's fear, y'all. That's the man side of God. But look when he turned it over and gave it to his Father. After he prayed, he was stronger, he was much better, and he was able to tell his Father, you know what, even if this bitter cup don't move, Sister Irma Allen, even if it don't move, guess what? Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. See, here's the kicker. There's the faith. You have to give God the prayer, and you also have to trust him after you leave it. So here it is. If you're going to get on your knees and pray, or if you're going to sit up and pray, some of our knees are too bad to get on our knees and pray, and that's still a blessing. But if you're going to pray, leave it with him. Don't go back and get it. Leave it with him. And that's what God is trying to tell him on the ship. Yep, I'm human, but I'm also God. And guess what? I can say to the winds and the waves. Isn't it amazing how the winds and the waves will obey God? Everything obeys God except man. Man is the only one that God has to whip back into shape because of our what? Unbelief. Because our selfishness. We want things our way. We want it when we live in a microwave society. Give it to me now. I'm not worried about what somebody else had. There's another thing in this pandemic. We have today, we have this pandemic. We have this COVID-19. But you know, God is keeping us well. And we need to do our part. But you know, still fear is there. When we talk to folk, when we go in stores. Just this morning, I went to Lowe's to get something. Early this morning, and I forgot my mask. But I always keep some in the truck. But when I got in the store, I remembered my mask. Now, I could have went on in the store and caused some confusion by not wanting to put on a mask. But you know what I did? I walked back to my truck, got my mask, and put it on. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm just telling you that we've got to do our part. We got to be mindful to take care of ourselves and our families. And you're going to see people who did not, don't want to wear masks. But we still have to take care of ourselves while what? Keeping our trust in Jesus Christ. God is not going to do for us what we can do for ourselves. And I think that's where a lot of times we look and don't see the power that God has given us. The power of prayer. The power of patience. The power of peace. Peace I give to you. You need to understand that this is all about Jesus stopping the winds and the waves. That's peace. And so we have to understand that Jesus is teaching them other things. Look at the faith. In one instance on it, they say, what manner of man is this? That he can talk to the winds and the waves. Jesus has given us some examples throughout the Bible, and that's why we need to read about how to handle faith. He gives us a perfect example. Don't you know Jesus, because of the man's side, that he was on his way to the cross? Don't you know that he feared? He didn't want to die on that cross, but it was the Father's will, and he accepted the Father's will. God called him to do that. And look, just like Isaiah, in chapter 6 of Isaiah, it says, on that day I saw the Lord sitting high and mighty, on the day that King Uzziah died. You need to understand that when he saw the Lord lifted up and high, and when he got on through the text and he says, who will I send? Isaiah says, here I am, Lord, send me. I just wonder how many of us would have been so afraid to even make that statement, Lord, I'm ready for you to go. Even if it's unto death, I'm ready. Don't fool me now. Because we all have that tenacity and that will to live forever. But honey, ain't gonna happen. One of these days, we're all gonna have to leave here. But fear, we have to understand that God went on to an old cross. He did not fear death itself because he had the promise of the Father that if he died on the cross to save mankind, he would raise him up on the third day. And so we have a blessing in knowing that God is who he say he is. He can do exceedingly abundant and above anything we can ever think or imagine. God is an awesome God. The other day we got a praise report showing you just how God is. This person is a family member of Sister Dorothy Sears, and he was dealing with some issues, and the other day they had him on the donor list, and listen to me carefully about how God is. How many of you do know God is good? And he'll give you what you need. But anyway, the story goes like this, that this man is needing a kidney, and he's needing a heart in order to make it. The other day, he gets a brand new kidney. Do you hear me? He gets a brand new kidney, and a few days later, he gets a 19-year-old's heart. To make it. Now, let me explain something to you, because I know some of your mind went to work. You said, wow, that was sad that a 19-year-old had to die and somebody had to give up a kidney. Don't you know Jesus gave his life for us? Every now and then, somebody had to die so that others will live. And Jesus gave us the prime example of hanging in there on an old rugged cross, dying so that he could save mankind. So don't let your mind wander. Whatever God does is perfect. Whatever he does it for a reason. I just believe that this man who got the things and got the things that he needed, God's got a plan for him. Amen. And God's got a plan for me and you. We might not need no heart physically, but we need a spiritual heart. It's room for improvement. We need that. We might not not need a kidney, but we need something within our bodies so that we won't be afraid and we can serve God. Amen? And so we need to understand that God is an awesome God. Here he is, that God proves it here. Not only did he pray for them, and not only did he protect and care for them, but guess what? His presence is mighty. Every now and then, when things might be array, I can feel the Spirit moving on the altar of my heart. Yeah, every now and then, you ought to be able to feel the Holy Spirit. You ought to know when God is trying to tell you something. You ought to know when God wants you to do something. And so here it is that we pray. The presence of the Lord, you can go anywhere. And no matter where it is, you think OnStar is good, God knows where you are. How many times have we been up and down the road? This is before we got these new fandango cars. How many times have you been up and down the road hoping to hoop if it'll just make it one more trip? I've been there. Had an old Ford Fairlane convertible and was coming out of Galveston and got across the causeway, got all the way back to Ross Street and Lamarck, and that's when it quit on me. I said, Lord, thank you, Jesus. I can walk to Phillips Street. I know he's good. Could have stopped on the causeway. Could have stopped in Galveston. And let me tell you something, Brother Paul, that was before I really had a relationship with Jesus Christ. Somebody ought to say amen. So God will protect you and keep you in perfect peace. You don't have to fear. You don't have to fret. God will take care of you. On an old rugged hill called Calvary, Jesus died for us. But you know that he overcame fear. How do you know he overcame fear? Because truly in the word of God, it says that they did not take his life. He freely gave it. So when you are overcome with your fear, you can do a lot of great things. I'm getting ready to close here now. If you keep your mind on Christ, if you trust him, you have the power, unbeknown to any other person, you have the power to stop Jesus and have him to listen to you all by yourself. You need a scripture? Well, you remember blind Bartimaeus? Blind Bartimaeus is blind. He's in this little room, and he's hear all this commotion on the street, walks to the outside. It's just as dark on the outside as it is on the inside. But blind Bartimaeus hears a commotion and realizes that it's Jesus passing by. And when his disciples would have him not to bother the master because he's on his way to pressing things and issues, he clearly says, thy son of David, have mercy on me. He said it again, thy son of David, have mercy on me. And Brother David, it says that Jesus stopped in his tracks, and as blind Bartimaeus, what would God have me to do? I got biblical scripture that if you talk to God, you can stop it. Hey, master, I want a little word with you. I think about that song, I'm meddling now, I think about that song by Luther Vandross. He says, hey, miss, where are you from? What's your name? Can I take you out tonight? Can I take you to a movie? Or can I take you out? If you don't stop Jesus, maybe he thinks you don't need him. You need to stop and talk to God and tell him what you need. God will tell you to wait sometime, but he's going to take care of you. So don't worry about the election. God is in control. Saul was once king too, but God, when he got ready to move him, he moved him. And we need to understand, don't worry about all that stuff you hear on TV, because that's the sale news. One minute you see this thing over here, this person is leading, the next time you see it, that person is leading. And I've been getting texts on my phone, and don't answer those texts. This person is losing, and I don't know how they got my phone number, but they are blowing up people's phone number. Don't worry about that. God is in control. Nobody can do anything more than what God allows them to do. We have to keep our faith, and just maybe God is letting all of this stuff happen, the pandemic and all of these other things that's happening, even in our leadership, because remember, Jesus told us that there was going to be crookedness in high places. We know about that. And so we need to understand, if we go into fear, then guess what? Fear with the trust in God, that one day he'll move that, amen? We've got to overcome it. Now, here's another thing. Fear doesn't just leave right now, because if you start thinking about the past and the future, guess what? You can stay up all day and stay inside. But guess what? If you trust God, if you walk with him, guess what? You've got power. You've got power to do a lot of great things. Do you know that the best arsenal, a weapon in our arsenal, is prayer?
Amen.
Have you ever seen a 145-ton 18-wheeler going down the road and somebody gets close and they put the air brakes on and all you hear is and it you leave some rubber marks in the road? Guess what? Prayer is nothing but air. And if you put it to the right use, you can heal people. And make people's lives better. You can bring peace and comfort to a weary soul. I know that for a fact, that God will give you the power to overcome whatever. If it, don't worry about it. God's got it. Yeah, God's got it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. You just go on and do your part and let God do his part. Amen? Yeah. On a hill called Calvary, remember, he died for us. He overcame fear for us. He came down for us, stayed in Joseph's borrowed tomb for 3 days. But here's the good news. Early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in heaven and earth in his hands. That is our sign to let us know that if we trust him, he can bring us through anything. Amen. Praise you. Bless God. Bless him. Trust him. Keep believing in him. Don't worry. Pray a lot and love a lot. May God bless you and keep you as our prayer. As the officers come, the doors of the church are now open. If you do not know him in the pardon of your sins, this is your opportunity. Whether if you be at home, whether it be in the cars, wherever you are, if you accept him, he loves you enough to make sure that everything will be okay. Just accept him. Just accept him and come into the fold.
It's all right. It's all right. makes it right. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our trouble. He will hear our faintest cry, and he'll answer by and by. Then you'll feel a little prayer wheel turning. You'll know a little fire is burning. Just a little talk with Jesus will make it all right. All right, this is the month of September. It's time to celebrate. It is time to look and wish well. Happy birthday. And best wishes to our following members. This is a lengthy list. Praise God, we have a lot of birthday celebrations and anniversaries. Happy birthday and best wishes to the following members. If I don't call your name, send me a text or honk your horn, blink your lights, and we want to celebrate you also today. Starting off the month, September 2nd, Sister Nell Ruth Hall. September 8th, Brother Kenneth Bill. September 9th, Sister Lena Woodfox. Also September 9th, Sister Flossie Holmes. September 12th, Sister Elzina Nolly. September 14th, Sister Ruby Nellums. Happy birthday, Sister Nellums. September 18th, Sister Augustine Spiller. Happy birthday, Sister Spiller. September 19th, Sister Ruby Davis. Where are you? Blink your lights. Yes. Also, September 19th, Brother Brandon Stark. September 21st, Sister Jackie Artie. September 25th, Sister Jocelyn Stokes. Happy birthday, Jocelyn. On yesterday, September 26th, celebrating her 97th birthday with Sister Grace Ann Evelyn. Today, celebrating her 57th birthday, Sister Evelyn. Michael Hinton. Pulling up the rear, but certainly not last, we have two celebrations on September 30th, Sister Irma Allen and Sister Lois Wilson. Amen. All right. We are known for having good examples of what a marriage looks like, and we have been blessed here at Greater Belle Zion. Celebrated on September 14th, 46 years, Brother Frank and Ida Parker.
September 17th, celebrating 22 years. programs to support her.